the Creado. We are all Creado, the gods, and we're all gods in spirit. So
I love.
So dear friends, family members, once there was a land of legendary loveliness, land of temperate summers, of crystal streams that flowed unrestrained through bountiful fields of vegetable and verdant acres of paddy cultivation. May the gentle murmur that stopped up fill the coolness of the morning air, and the fleeting oriole glimmered glow through the blossoming blades of mango and of bird. And here, in this paradise of the 1930s, we lived, us two or three, rather three generations and families of Creados. The only Creados of our own village, somewhat aloof from the other Marathi-speaking villagers, we lived in the baronial isolation of our ancestral mansions, more than a generation apart from the oldest to the youngest. But, as my dear mother would always say, blood is thicker than water, and so we inevitably bonded together in the shade, bonded together like one twin tree, in the shade of the old Bora tree. The eldest of course was our revered patriarch, Peter John Creado, thanks to his care, therefore thanks to his comfortable youth provided by his adoptive parents, Joao and Kathleen Creado. And the property bestowed on him by them. He rose to be a person of eminence and wealth, a far-thinking and progressive person who even set up the first English language school in the village. And even we, his grandsons, asked to call him and I, had the privilege of studying there many years and many generations later. And of course, the oldest, the wisest, and the most venerable of Peter John's was Peter John's eldest son, our dearest Uncle A.B., Anthony Philip Creado, a highly intelligent and saintly man, a man who forgave in the true Christian spirit, and who always remained close to his father, in life, as in death, even choosing to be laid beside him to rest when his own time came. And there was his ever-devoted and self-effacing wife, Edith Ann, contented and fulfilled with her own family and her home and her beloved rose garden by the lake. And most outstanding of all was their eldest son, Stanley, the most dynamic, dashing, and daring figure. He was all by his voice, a resounding baritone. He worked in the airlines, and we never tired of listening to his exciting exploits. And he was one of the first, he worked in the airlines, and he was one of the first with his team to return to venture out to the Powai in a bleak and rain-lashed July day, when the ill-fated KLM plane crashed in the Powai Hill. And there was Bertram, rather quiet and aloof, and civil, excitable, intelligent, and articulate. And Noreen, somewhat restrained, quiet and aloof, with her enigmatic Mona Lisa sort of smile, her unpleasant disposition, which she preferred to remain eclipsed by the aura of her eldest sister, Sybil. And Daphne, fun-loving and vivacious, and Muriel, the eldest, somewhat removed from us by her early marriage to the romantic violinist Adrian, an intense intellectual and romantic figure indeed. And of course, there was the truant loving, carefree and completely irresponsible country. The youngest, who calls his poor father and no end of worry and anxiety. And there was a much younger generation of Creados. And Kapri was of course our dosat, as my mother called it. There was a much younger generation of Creados, fathered by Victor Gabriel Creado, a wonderful, very Christian gentleman, and like his own father, forward-looking and progressive. He drove a car even in those 1930s, a large English Austin, I think it was, cranking handle, trumpet horn, running board and all. A great achievement for any Christian in those days. He loved the good life and managed to live it, but was careful and prudent enough not to throw away his money on need for luxuries, to provide a good standard of life and education to his wife and children. He foresaw the end of agriculture and the need for more progressive education. He even married Vanderbilt, a college graduate, and brought her home to the village, but not before he had electrified the house and garden for his champagne reception in my own village. And his wife Blossom, intensely religious, home loving, and family loving, a poised, fair, and striking figure in any social gathering, a diehard disciplinarian, but a loving and patient mother and caring mother, and a sweet makeup par excellence. And of course, there was a still very regal, the patient and loving Rosa Antonia, the wife of Peter John. In her days of decline, she would still say, wistfully, "They used to call me Senora."
Great.
And the five sons of it then, Gabriel, he was immensely proud of, beginning with Neil John, tall and romantic, the typical ladies' man, and Daryl, affectionately known as Dara Duck, and by Uncle Apias, Darabsha Daruba, Dorabji Daruba. The girl was adventurous, multi-talented, musical and artistic, spirited and determined. He was one of the first to hoist a silver sail and venture beyond the far horizons of Endero. And of course, the less said, and then of course there was me. And the less said about me, the better. But suffice it to say that I was aloof, nature-loving, and eccentric, or abnormal, if you will. And calling, not too serious or ambitious, and Aster, the pampered pet of the family, affectionately called by my mother as Estamari Quash.
And Bijou.
But as my dear mother always said, blood is thicker than water. So we two generation of Creados wandered effortlessly and inevitably together, each in his or her own diversity. Yes. And we joined together, bonded together. In song, carefully loved and good-hearted family camaraderie. And yes, we loved singing, with Daryl playing the piano, and all of us clustered around singing, playing the song from the Binaka Hit Parade. Our favorites being Harry Belafonte, and of course the others. Listen to that obnoxious cricket commentary. Bolly Omanda bowling to serve the world. Bolly Omanda bowling to serve the And on that magical day in June, and of course, I cannot end this without saying something about St. Anthony's Feast,
yes,
which is the high point, the highlight of the whole year. So, on that magical day in June, the village explored. The village came vibrantly alive with feasting and its music, as explosions of wondrous harmony. As we sang the St. Anthony's Feast Day Mass, even on the days before the most enjoyable of the year, even the days running up to the Mass were the most enjoyable of the year, as we all practiced late into the night, with Adrian playing the violin, and a great deal of fun and laughter and limited. On that day, when we sang the feast mass, the poor aging choir master had a welcome respite in singing his mass in his tired, quavering voice, and accompanying himself with his one-string violin. The poor man must have been much, much relieved, I'm sure, and that one-string also finally broke. and he was at last able to retire, no longer had to listen to the old monk. And the days preceding the feast were indeed spirited, as at the close of day, the processionists marched through the village. John Dee. Dum 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 malapani din. Dum 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 malapani din. Praying for copious rains and bountiful harvests. And of course, the drunks and derelicts of the village always managed to tag along at the tail end of the procession. But they would be singing a slightly different tune. And if one listened closely, it would be, one could hear them singing, not Chantan Ton Malapani Day, but Chantan Ton Maladawi Day. No, in the end it was not the wedding bells that broke up our society, but in fact we enjoyed weddings, and Stanley's and Rita's glittering wedding reception in the Taj Mahal room was indeed a wondrous first for a Morocco, and it was the talk of the town. But it was time's ruinous embrace that did it, as the city crept up unnoticed and engulfed us all, putting a final end to agriculture. And in the end, Marol was not progressive enough for those of us who wanted to move on in life and out into the modern world. And so, reluctantly, we left, all except the faithful and aging Uncle Abe and his devoted daughters, Tibble and Laurie. But however far we roam, we always yearn to return to the land of our forefathers, together for family reunions in the shade of the old Borat tree. And that final journey drew many of us home at last, to be laid to rest in the hallowed ground of our forefathers, beside them in death as in life. After all, bone is as bonding as blood. And so we come at last to rest, there in that peaceful country churchyard, even as the twilight falls upon the land, and the distant hills recede into the lilac shadows of repose, as the dwindling echoes of the Angelus fade into the silence of the falling dusk, and the bulbul sings his restful melody in the blossoming mango tree, and of course accompanied by the spirit of the ancient choir master, still playing his one-string violin, in his quavering voice, singing his mournful Latin dirges. But this is the kind of part. But I have no doubt that way before the day of the resurrection, the good Lord himself will come and wake us and take us by the hand, us Creados, and join us hand in hand, and bid us enter into the kingdom. And we shall enter, for we are Creados together, we shall enter there. Triumphantly marching at the tune of When the Saints Go Marching In, and with Saint Anthony leading us into the bloody gates himself.
Yeah!
Fantastic, Winston.
Thank you.
Thank you.